Dear students, welcome to EPG Padasala. Today, in the subject Aesthetics and Fine Arts, we are going to continue the portions of Kavyas. I am Professor Tyagarajan, head of the Department of Sanskrit, Prestigious College, Chennai. We have already seen in the earlier modules the origin of the Kavya and the influence of Valmiki over the poets and the role of Kalidasa, his contributions, his genius, his other merits, his descriptive power, and his title Upama Kalidasasya, and so on. In this module, we are going to know about the Kavyas of Bharavi, Magha, Sriharsha, and also Bhatti, Pravarasena, Kumaradasa, Kshemendra, Mankha, Neelakanta, Vedanta Deshika. Now we will take up the Kiratarjuniyam of Bharavi. There is a saying, Dandinaha Padalalityam Bharavehe Arthagauravam Upama Kalidasasya Maghe Santi Trayogunaha, which means Dandin, a poet who contributed Dasakumara Charita and other works, is a master in using very lucid words, letters, Pada Lalityam. Bharavehe Arthagauravam. Bharavi is noted for giving you the exact best cute meanings. He is esteemed for his expression of the meaning. Bharavehe Artha Gauravam. Then Upama Kalidasasya, we have already seen that Kalidasa is noted for his apt similes. The Kavya of Bharavi is Kiratarjuniya. As his name is mentioned in the Aikol inscription of 634 AD, he has been placed during the close of 6th century AD. He was the court poet of King Durvinita, who ruled up to 580 AD. In his court, he wrote his only poem, Kiratarjuniyam. The poem in 18 cantos deals with Arjuna's career described in the Vanaparva of Mahabharata. Arjuna sets out to win the weapon called Pashupatastra. Pashupatastra means the astra given by Pashupati, the Lord Shiva. That's why it is called Pashupatastra. So Arjuna wanted to get this particular astra or the weapon or missile from Lord Shiva by doing some austerities. So it is in order to fight Kauravas, he wanted to secure that Pashupatastra. So Arjuna's severe austerities frightened the gods. Generally, whenever somebody does some austerities, performs some yajnas, the gods are very much afraid. It is not out of place to say that whenever a person does a sacrifice or more number of sacrifice, or it is even said that if a person does 100 sacrifices, he becomes Indra. Therefore, the gods are very much afraid to get rid of their seeds. So they come and disturb the austerities, penances of the seers. Now, being afraid, the gods appealed to Lord Shiva to descend as Kirata, and who disputes with Arjuna in the matter of killing a boar. So both of them come there, and then they are both Arjuna and Kirata are targeting the boar, but there is a quarrel between both of them. Then after the quarrel, Shiva reveals his true form and grants the devotee, that is Arjuna, the desired weapon. Bhargava's description has great power and vigor. In the earlier module, I told about the paka. Kalidasa is noted for Draksha paka, and Bhargava is noted for Narikela paka. That is, you have to remove the skin, break the shell, and then only you can enjoy with regard to the coconut. Like that, you have to first of all understand what Bhargava says, and then try to understand the meaning of it in deep sense, and then only you will admire how beautifully he has described this particular aspect. So Narikela paka. Narikela means coconut in Sanskrit. So there are also great defects in his writings, but at the same time he has got number of maxims. Arthantara Nyasa. When you say Arthantara Nyasa, you must know what is Arthantara Nyasa. Arthantara Nyasa means that you are giving an idea being substantiated by a maxim. For an example, I quote from Jayadeva's Chandraloka, wherein he defines and illustrates Arthantara Nyasa Alankara. It is a figure of speech where he says, Hanuman Abdim Atarat Dushkaram Kim Mahatmanam. He says, Hanuman crossed the ocean. This is the general statement, and that is being enhanced, substantiated by another statement saying, Dushkaram Kim Mahatmanam. Hanuman Abdim Atarate means Hanuman crossed the ocean. Dushkaram Kim Mahatmanam, what is not possible for great people? So this sentence enhances the power of Hanuman there. So just like general sentences or maxims are attributed, and with regard to Bhargava, he handles lot of Arthantara Nyasa Alankaras. He sets bad example in his fondness for showing his skill in grammar. Generally, even in teaching grammar, nowadays people say that you should teach grammar through literature. Straight away, if you are mentioning the aphorisms or the sutras and then try to explain it, the application part of it will not be grasped by the students. Therefore, grammar should be taught through literature is the convention that has come into vogue. Now, he is fond of showing his skill in grammar. In Canto 15, there are some slokas which give one meaning when read forward, as usual, and other sense when read backward. Just like reading Urdu, if you are reading, you get one meaning. In ordinary reading, you get one meaning. This is a device followed by some poets, but to grasp the meaning, it will be very difficult. Generally, Bhargava is praised for his artha gaurava, that means deep thought of his expression. Bhargavehe artha gauravam. And this work, though he has written only one work. That work has given him a title, just like Kalidasa gained the title Deepashikha Kalidasa Chatrabharavihi. He describes beautifully an umbrella in his work. That beauty has attributed his this title Chatrabharavi. And now we come to Maga, who wrote Shishupalavadha. This work is also called as Magam. After Kalidasa and Bharavi, Magabhatta occupies the next important place, as he has made a reference to the drama Naganandam of Sriharsha of 7th century AD in his Shishupalavadha. He is generally assigned to 7th century AD. Taking the well-known episode from Mahabharata epic, Maga has written his only work Shishupalavadha or Magam in 20 cantos. Dharmaputra performs a sacrifice called Rajasuya Yaga after his victory over demon Jarasandha. The first offering of honor, which must be shown to great person in the assembly, is shown to Sri Krishna by the advice of Bhishma and other elders. Shishupala, a foe of Krishna, protests against the procedure and rebukes both Krishna and Bhishma. His protocol is different. A fight starts between Krishna and Shishupala in this regard, in which Krishna slays Shishupala. That is the crux of the story of Shishupalavadha. Though there are few changes when compared to the epic Mahabharata, it has been considered that Shishupalavadha is a work of great poetical merit. From Maga's Shishupalavadha, it is clear that he wrote his poem immediately after Bharavi. Traditionally, Maga has been admired for his combination in his work, the similes of Kalidasa, the deep thought of Bharavi, and delicacy of expression of Dandin. That's what I said. Dandinaha Padalalityam Bharavehe Arthagauravam Upama Kalidasasya Maghe Santi Trayogunaha. That means Dandin has got the delicacy of expression. Then Bharavehe Arthagauravam, Bharavi has got meaningful expressions, excellent, meaningful thought. Upama Kalidasa is a simile of Kalidasa. Maghe Santi Trayoguna. All the three qualities are found in Maga. Maga, though, has contributed the only work, Shishupalavadha, has given him a very good title, just like Kalidasa attained, just like Bharavi attained. He also attained a title, Ganta Maga, where he is describing the bell in his work. Next, we come across a good poet, Sriharsha. His Mahakavya is Naishadam. We must know at this juncture that this Harsha is totally different from the dramatic Harsha, who belonged to 7th century AD. Harsha was patronized by King Vijayachandra of Kannauj in the later half of 12th century AD. With the aid of Chintamani Mantra, so kindly communicated to him by a venerable sage, Harsha attained proficiency in all branches of learning. He was received with distinction by King Vijayachandra. In his court, he wrote his Naishadhiya Charita. With regard to poets, generally we come across the divine grace for their ability to compose, and for which, just like Kalidasa, who prays to Kali and gets the inspiration, for some mantras are being given as the inspiration, and this Chintamani Mantra is spoken of as a mantra which gives all the ability for speech and writing. And it appears that this poet attained that mantra from a seer. The story has been taken from the Mahabharata epic. The original story found in the epic is simple and in beautiful style. The original of Ramayana and Mahabharata happen to be always simple because they are composed in Anushtup meter. And the sentences are also very easy to understand. And the poets of later ages, when they take up the plot or the informations, they sometimes, if I am not mistaken, complicate by way of decorating their speech. Of course, that is also a part of a poetic expression. So, they make alankaras, and thereby the reader sometimes struggles to understand the ideas conveyed by the poet. The original story found in the epic is simple. The style in the Naishadha is very tough, requiring the help of a commentary to understand the meaning. So, he has been considered as a most difficult writer. Though his style is much tough, his imagination, power of observation and description of nature are decidedly of very high order. There is a saying with regard to Sriharsha and his work Naishadam. Naishadam Vidvad Aushadam. The work Naishadha is the medicine for all poets. Here we must understand, when you say medicine, it is always good. But conventionally we think that medicine means bitter. But however, it gives you a good remedy. Therefore, the saying Naishadam Vidvad Aushadam means that it enhances the brain of composing poems by other poets. So, it gives you an inspiration to follow his writings and his expressions. Therefore, Naishadam Vidvad Aushadam. It does not mean that one should get terrified by this work. It is understandable provided you have a commentary or a person who can give a good explanation for the sentences. See, in the Nishadha country, there was a king called Nala. His love for the princess of Vidarbha, Damayanti, his love message through Swan, the intervention of the Dikpalas, the marriage after Swayamvara, etc., are narrated in that work. At the end of each canto, the poet makes reference to his verse and parentage. So, that is a system he follows. Generally, the poets are always self-effacing. They don't reveal their entire family, how they lived, the parentage, and their sometimes even where he studied and all. But sincerely, Sriharsha does that in every canto. Next, we come across Prabhasena, a writer who wrote the work called Setubandha. Bana and Dandin of 7th century AD have paid glowing tributes to Prabhasena in their respective works. So, he is assigned to 6th century AD. His Mahakavya Setubandha, or Building of the Bridge, is written in Maharashtric Prakrit. It describes the bridge built by the monkeys in the epic Ramayana. This is also called Setukavya or Ravanavadha. This is also an evidence to prove that Rama built up a bridge for Lanka. Next is Bhatti Kavya. Bhatti is the name of a poet, and the Kavya composed by him is actually Ravana Vadha, but generally it is known as Bhatti Kavya itself. Bhatti Kavya or Ravana Vadha, describing the story of Ramayana in 22 cantos, is the Mahakavya. As the poet himself says that he was a contemporary of King Sridharasena of 6th century AD. He is assigned to 7th century AD. Bhatti's poem is more a manual of grammar than a poem with artistic value. The aim of the poet is to illustrate the various rules of Sanskrit grammar besides aesthetic expressions. The poet says that his work is a light to those whose eyes are grammar, and justifies without grammar, it is a mirror in the hand of a blind. So this justifies that this particular work is meant for teaching grammar through literature. So in that way, Bhatti Kavya attains a special recognition. Next we come across Kumaradasa, a poet whose work is Janaki Harana. Taking the source from the great epic Ramayana, Kumaradasa of 7th century AD wrote his Janaki Harana in about 20 cantos. The free use of certain grammatical forms in the book shows that the author is conversant with the grammatical work Kashikavritti of 650 AD. Just like Panini, Bhattoji Dikshita, you have got a grammar work called Kashikavritti, which is much exclaimed by the grammarians. So there is no contradiction in fixing his date as 7th century AD. The story described here differs from Ramayana in various details. His style is simple. He tried to produce the style of Kalidasa. Generally, all the poets after Kalidasa, having read Kalidasa, try to imitate him or try to borrow certain phrases also. Because Kalidasa, being the predecessor, has given inspiration, and the poets also having high esteem over Kalidasa's expressions, try to follow. Now, Harichandra's Dharma Sharma Abhyudaya is a work to be of preaching Jainism, because he belonged to Digambara cult of Jainism. He wrote his Mahakavya Dharma Sharma Abhyudaya in 2 cantos, describing the life of the Jain saint Dhananatha. He belongs to 9th century AD. Now, Haravijaya is a work written by Ratnakara. He is a court poet of King Avantivarman of Kashmir. He is more often referred to as Rajanaka Ratnakara Vagishwara. The very title Vagishwara gives him the merit that he is the lord of words. That means his words convey excellent meanings and also the meaningful words are being chosen by him, chosen words he uses in his work. Haravijaya is the Mahakavya written by him. It describes in 48 cantos. See, so many cantos. There is a more number of cantos if you find, it is only in this work. The story of killing the demon Antaka, Shiva's own son, by Shiva himself is narrated. The poem has very little artistic value, but this is the biggest Mahakavya in Sanskrit literature. Then Nalodaya. Vasudeva's Nalodaya, describing the story of Nala found in the Nalopakhyana of Mahabharata, Vasudeva wrote his Naludaya or Rise of Nala in 4 cantos. Long compounds, difficult meters, and frequent use of alliterations in this poem speak of the poet's lack of aesthetic sense. It is generally believed that whenever you use long compounds, hair-splitting puns, and bombastic verbal expressions, people generally underestimate that work because of the trouble in understanding the meaning of the work. When you are straining to understand the meaning, then the work happens to be somewhat boring for any person. Therefore, in that sense, we can say he lacks the aesthetic sense. He has written another work, that is Yudhishthira Vijaya, in which he describes the story of Yudhishthira till his victory in the great war. Next, we come across the Kavyas of Kshemendra. He is a court poet of the 11th century AD. King Ananta of Kashmir happened to be his patron. He was the student of the great Alankarika Abhinav Gupta, who happened to have commented upon Bharata's Natyashastra, and Abhinav Gupta has got his own place in the history of Sanskrit poetics. He has successfully abridged the story of Ramayana, Mahabharata, and Dashavatara. In his Ramayana Manjari, Mahabharata Manjari, and Dashavatara Manjari, he has abridged the entire stories in the poetry form. He has also abridged Gunadya's Brihatkatha in his Brihatkatha Manjari. Brihatkatha is a work by Gunadya. It is said that it is written in Paishachi language. Paishachi means the Pishashi, we call it, which means goblins. So, it is the language of goblins. That's what people say, but we do not know whether that interpretation is exactly right. But anyway, we can understand that there existed a language called Paishachi, which is now lost. So also, the work of Gunadya, that is Brihatkatha, was also lost. But fortunately, Kshemendra and a few more others have just brought the ideas of Brihatkatha into their works. Some have composed in the form of poetry, some people have composed in the form of prose also. Next comes Mankha, a poet who has written Sri Kanthacharita. He is also a Kashmirian poet patronized by King Jayasimha of 12th century AD. He wrote his Sri Kanthacharita describing the victory of Lord Shiva over the demons of Tripuras in 25 cantos. Though the poem lacks poetic merits, it is important for the historical points because it brings out the Puranic story of Tripura being burnt by Shiva. It is narrated in the poetry form. So those who have no access to Puranas or those who could not read the Puranas, they can, by reading this Sri Kanthacharita, understand the meaning and also enjoy the poetic beauty in it. Then we come across Kaviraja, who has written Raghava Pandaviya. So Raghava is Rama, Pandaviya means belonging to Pandavas. So he is able to describe both the Raghava and Pandavas in one kavya called Raghava Pandaviya. So it describes simultaneously the story of Ramayana and Mahabharata. That is the idea. This type of kavya is called Dvisandhana Kavya. Each sloka can be interpreted both according to Rama and Pandava princess. He is ranked with the great poets Bana and Subandhu in the use of Alankara Vakrokti. See, Vakrokti is an Alankara as well as a theory of poetry for which Kuntaka happens to be the promulgator. This Kaviraja has also written Parijata Harana, another Mahakavya, describing the story of the bringing of the celestial Parijata tree to placate Rukmini by Krishna. Now, we come across other South Indian poet called Vedanta Deshika. Venkatanatha or Vedanta Deshika, the 14th century Vaishnavite poet and philosopher, has contributed profusely for the development of the various branches of Sanskrit literature. His Yadava Abhyudaya, in 24 cantos, describes in simple and pleasing style the story of Lord Krishna described in the Bhagavata Purana. This poem has been commented by the great philosopher and poet Appaya Dikshita of 17th century. Paduka Sahasra, a devotional lyric, then Hamsa Sandesa, an erotic lyric, Subhashita Nivi, a didactic poem, a moral poem, and Sankalpa Suryodaya, an allegorical drama, describing the principles of Visishtadvaita philosophy, or some of his other works of great literary merit. Vedanta Deshika is noted for his Stotra Kavyas also. His Samsa Sandesa is purely an imitation, the researchers say, of Kalidasa. So, for all the Sandesa Kavyas that came after Kalidasa have been inspired by Kalidasa alone. Now, we come to another poet, Chidambara Kavi. He is also a noted writer who composes difficult poems. It is very difficult to understand him, but at the same time, you can enjoy the rhythm in him. He is one who could write poems with what you call the anuprasas, yamakas, etc. in a very simple and easy way. This poet is an expert in using puns also. He was patronized by King Venkata I of 17th century AD. He wrote a Trisandana Kavya called Raghava, Yadava, Pandaviya, describing simultaneously the story of Rama, Pandava princess and Krishna. So, if you straight away read, you get Ramayana. And just like reading Urdu, if you read, you get Bhagavata. If you split the sentences and read, then you get Mahabharata also. So, that's why it is called Trisandhana Kavya. It is very, very difficult. In one poem, if you have to convey three stories, it is very difficult. That in which Chidambara has definitely succeeded. Then Neelakanta Dikshita is a very well noted writer in Sanskrit literature. He was the court poet of King Tirumalai Nayaka, who ruled Madurai from 1623 AD to 1659 AD. A great philosopher and poet, Neelakanta Dikshita has contributed to all the branches of Sanskrit literature. His Mahakavya Shivalila Arnava in 22 cantos describes the 64 sportive leelas of Lord Shiva described in the Halasya Mahatmya. Another incomplete Mahakavya Mukunda Vilasa Kavya describing the story of Lord Muruga is also attributed to him. So the Kali Vidambana and other Kavyas, minor Kavyas also written by Neelakanta. He is a serious poet as well as a humorous writer. And one example of Nilakanta as a humorous writer, I would like to say that he wrote on Kalividambanam. That means a satire on the people who are living during Kali Yuga. One example, he sees a teacher and then says that you teach, you ask the student to read, and then he advises the teacher, if you ask the student to read, and if he raises any question, you say, after reading, you yourself will get the meaning. And with regard to an astrologer, he says that if you are an astrologer, people will come and ask you how many years they will live. Then immediately, being an astrologer, don't look into the planets and then say that you will live for this many years. For the life is in the hand of God. So don't predict the age of a person. Instead, you can say that you will live for 100 years. And if the person who asks for the prediction lives for 100 years, then he will say, he is a great astrologer because he said that I will live for 100 years, I am living. If he dies, is he going to come and then ask you why you have bluffed? So, such criticisms are very humorously rendered by Nilakanta Dikshita. In this module, you have seen Bharavi, Magha, and their merits, and some of the other poets also, like Kumaradasa and others, and the contents of the poems and the period of their living, etc. This will give you an idea that how the Kavyas have been developing and how Kalidasa and other great poets have inspired the succeeding writers in the development of the Kavyas in Sanskrit literature. Thank you.